You're listening to the Tel Aviv Review here on TLV1. I'm Gilad Halpern. Welcome back. I'm now joined here in the studio by Professor Alon Confino. He's a historian teaching at the University of Virginia in the United States, as well as Ben-Gurion University of the Negev here in Israel. And he's also the author of a new book called A World Without Jews, The Nazi Imagination from Persecution to Genocide, which has recently been published by Yale University Press, all in English, of course. Hello, Alon. Welcome to the Tel Aviv Review.
Thanks for having me.
So let's start with what I believe is really the crux of your argument, what you call the Nazi imagination. Unlike many other studies of the Nazi period and the Holocaust, you don't focus only on what the Nazis did so much as on what they believed they were doing. Why is this distinction so important?
I was interested in the story the Nazis told themselves in order to justify and legitimize the persecution and extermination of the Jews. We all tell ourselves stories about our life, individuals and collectivities. And these stories we tell ourselves are not in order to get the past right or the facts right. Actually, they are in order to get the facts wrong, in order to explain ourselves the meaning of our life and why we do certain things. And when you do a bad thing, like exterminating millions of people, you just might as well have a very good story to go along with it in order to explain to yourself why is it that you have to do it, that it is justified. Mm-hmm. So I looked back at what the Nazis told themselves about who they were and why they did what they did. I looked back at their history and I traced the story they told themselves and how in this story they had to eradicate the Jews from Germany, but also from Europe, and ultimately from the world, in order to build their own civilization.
Mm-hmm. But you're talking about the history of the Nazis. So we're talking about really the very early intellectuals of the Nazi movement from the 1920s, or are we talking even before that?
No, actually, my book starts in 1933 when Hitler assumed the power, and it ends in 1945. So it's only about the Third Reich. Mm-hmm. It's the stories the Nazis told themselves during
but
the
But these stories life. Take a lot of time to take hold. I mean, it's not something that is done overnight, right?
No, of course. It takes time. But there is an element of immediacy to it. Because the Nazis had to explain certain things immediately. Why you need to persecute the Jews in 1933. Why you need to kick them out from the schools, from the universities. Then why you need to burn all the synagogues. Mm-hmm. So while the story itself has roots in the past, its construction is often quite immediate. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm not so interested in intellectuals. I'm interested in what happened on the street level, on everyday life.
Mm-hmm. Because the interesting thing here is that, according to your line of argument, the extermination of the Jews wasn't only the physical thing, wasn't only Auschwitz as the symbol of the Holocaust per se, but not only the eradication of Jewish presence in the present and future of humanity, but more so in the history of humanity.
Precisely.
So how did they exactly try to recalibrate human history to fit their needs?
So they said that the Jews are the source of all evil. Now, we have to understand that we are talking here about fantasies, not about facts. It won't help us if we'll explain the Nazis that they are wrong. They were not into facts. They were into fantasies. So the Jews were the source of all evil from early humanity to the Bible and to modernity with all the things that were associated with the Jews. Capitalism, Bolshevism, psychoanalysis, homosexuality.
Some of them are complete opposites and mutually exclusive.
Absolutely. Yeah. This was the power of the Jewish symbol for the Nazi imagination.
That were Bolsheviks and capitalists at the same time.
Precisely. Mm-hmm. And the way that they reconciled it in their mind, each one of them believed in parts of this whole, but you didn't have to believe in all of it. Mm-hmm. But that's the power of stereotype, of
But wasn't this crusade, shall we call it, against humanity at large, or against Western civilization? Because all that you're saying here, both Bolshevism and capitalism, both the Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, and the entire history of the Judeo-Christian civilization, I don't know if the Nazis used this term at all, is based in some way or another on Jewish history.
That's true, but I see the Nazis as part of European history and a part of Western civilization.
Did they see themselves as part of Western civilization?
Absolutely. They saw themselves as the defender of Europe and the West and the good ideals from the Jewish infiltration and Jewish ideas that started from the Bible, from the morality embedded in the Ten Commandments, but then continued with the French Revolution, with the idea of liberty, with the idea of equality, with the idea of human rights. They were all Jewish ideas, quote unquote. Mm. So the Nazis saw themselves as giving an alternative to communism and to liberalism. And when we think about the 20s and the 30s, they were not the only one. Mm-hmm. Mussolini gave such an alternative, fascism, Nazism. And we also have to think that in the mid-30s, liberalism didn't have such a good press.
It seemed on the decline.
Yes, precisely. It seemed in a decline following the Depression, and Bolshevism was one way to rejuvenate the West, and the Nazis rejected it. So they had a third way in between.
Speaking of Bolshevism and communism, there have been studies that argued that the Nazi imagination, or the development of Nazi politics and the policies at large, came in response to the communist threat. What do you make of that?
Certainly, Nazism and fascism in Italy, Germany, or Spain came also as a political response to Bolshevism. The idea that class is more important than the nation. But this cannot explain the Holocaust, because if the nation is the most important thing, then why do you have to be obsessed with the Jews? The idea of class itself, or of Bolshevism, cannot explain why do you need to eradicate all the Jews from the face of the earth, also the Jews that are workers, or also the Jews that wanted to be Germans. So in order to explain the Holocaust, we have to go beyond the political division.
But the Holocaust, if we can break down the Nazi period, which was a very short time, just 12 years, into several stages, the Holocaust and the physical extermination of the Jews came rather late in the game. The final solution was only declared in 1941, I think, or 1942? 41.
Yeah. January 1942, the Wannsee Conference.
The Wannsee Conference was 42.
Right.
Yeah. So, I mean, It was a game changer in many, many respects. So aren't you, it's not a spiteful question per se, but aren't you reading history backwards in a sense?
That's an excellent question. So what I'm trying to understand is how the Nazis imagined a world without Jews from the beginning of the Third Reich. So at the beginning, this was not a world without Jews. This was my neighborhood without Jews. Tel Aviv without Jews, the schools without Jews, Tel Aviv University without Jews. Of course, I'm now... That's a metaphor.
Yeah, they famously wanted to send them to Madagascar and other places in the
world. This came in 1940. But when we speak in 1933, 34, so already German society acquiesced to the idea that my private life, my professional life, my law firm will have no Jews. But we don't want to kill the Jews. We don't want to exterminate them. We are going to send them to Palestine, perhaps, or to America. When the Nazis in 1937, 38, 39 decided also to expand and to build an empire, so the idea of my hometown or Germany without Jews was linked now to the idea of a Europe and a world without Jews, because they had also worldwide domination fantasies.
That they didn't espouse before? It came rather late in the...
In the mid-30s, the Germans don't think, the Nazis, they don't think about Auschwitz, they don't think about extermination. This really comes only in the war. But there is already an imagination that my town should be without Jews, and it is justified. The Jews are the source of all evil. when the Nazis want to expand this idea to Europe as a whole, they need a very good idea to go with it. And it is then that they burn the Hebrew Bible and they burn all the synagogues in Kristallnacht, in the night of broken glass in 1938, which really presents them as a new morality.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying basically that the burning of the books was more than just a symbolic act?
Of course, to burn the Hebrew Bible in a European Christian civilization, this is a very strong symbolic act. Mm-hmm. And we have to ask ourselves, why did the Nazis burn the Hebrew Bible? One of the main interpretations for the Holocaust in the last generation is that it was motivated by racial ideas. And mm-hmm. there is no doubt about that.
Yeah.
But this does not explain why then the Nazis wanted to burn a religious, a holy symbol or book like the Bible. If it's all about race, yeah. So then religious is... And I want to say there was more to it, because they wanted to create a new past, a past which will eradicate the Jews, the Bible, the Ten Commandments, and the morality that goes along with it.
And how did Christianity fit into all this? What was their attitude towards it as, you know, a part of the old world, but also something that in many ways relied on this great abomination that was provided by the Jews?
So for a long time, Christianity and racial ideas were seen as two opposites. So the historians that emphasized racial ideas downplayed Christianity. And I wanted to bring Christianity, religious sentiments, into the picture and into our explanation. Because the Nazis' anti-Semitism took a lot from traditional anti-Semitism while being revolutionary in itself. So the Nazis did not want to eradicate Christianity. They wanted to eradicate the Jewish origins of Christianity.
Mm-hmm. They were perfectly happy with Christianity per se. It's just that its reliance on Judaism that was problematic.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And did they actually look into it in detail? Was there any theological endeavor to try and do it? Maybe in conjunction with Christian theologians? Is it even possible?
Exactly so, yes. Mm-hmm. So in 1939, they found this Institute for the Eradication of Jewish Culture in German Religious Beliefs, one of these long German names, which had the most famous and important German theologians, but also anthropologists and historians and all sorts of people. And they all thought about how will Christianity look after the Nazi victory.
Uh-huh.
They already thought that there will be a war.
Sure.
So they already eliminated the Old Testament from Christianity because they burned it in 1938. And now they were thinking about new rituals, new hymns, new form of worship.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that they came up with was a New Testament, a new version of the New Testament. They took out all the connections between Jesus and the house of David, all the good reference to the Jews in the New Testament. They made Jesus from a guy who gives the other chick into a virile soldier-like Nazi Tom Cruise style Jesus.
Tall and blonde, of course.
And this book... Yeah, tall and broad, of course.
Of course.
With Aryan origins.
Sure,
okay.
Yeah.
And this book sold for 200,000 copies. Now, I'm not saying that necessarily this idea would have won had the Nazis won the war, but I'm saying the Nazis thought about it. This was not some kind of some fringe elements. They thought about how to reconcile Nazi racism, Christianity, and anti-Judaism. And that's the package that they came with.
Very interesting. You said earlier that they relied on classical anti-Semitism and revolutionized it in a way. What were really the tenets that they borrowed from old anti-Semitism, and what were the new ones that they reinvented?
There is always a continuity and change in the way that we think about concepts. So anti-Semitism had a long history. You didn't need to explain it in European and German society. Some of its symbols went back to the Middle Ages.
Mm-hmm.
So the Nazis, when they talked the talk of anti-Semitism, actually based it on common ideas in German society, which they didn't need to invent. They didn't need to invent the wheel. It was there. However, they gave it a new twist. The new twist was, first of all, a modern racial ideas. Mm-hmm. That it is not, that the main thing is not religious anti-Semitism, but racial anti-Semitism.
It's not to convert all the Jews to Christianity, precisely, but eliminate them completely.
Yeah, and that's the main difference between religious and racial anti-Semitism.
You cannot, it's a big difference.
Huge difference. Mm-hmm. You cannot become an Aryan if you are a Jew.
Yeah.
But you can become a Christian if you are a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
So the
and also
idea,
the Jews are invited to become Christians, whereas the even if the Jews wanted to be Aryans, whether it was possible at all, they would be completely rejected.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And this is the power of modern.
So is there any truth in the claim that we hear often that new anti-Semitism is a reincarnation of old anti-Semitism, or was the Nazi period unique in this sense?
No, the Nazi period was not unique. The Nazis took ideas that were common in European and German society, but as always, they took it to the max. They took it to an extreme. Mm-hmm. But in a sense, they did not invent anything ex nihilo. They didn't invent anything, mm-hmm, you know, just really.
Out of the blue. Yeah.
And I think that it's much more useful to see Nazism and the Holocaust as part of modern European history, the history of modern genocides. It has a beginning, it has an end, it has a context, it has a historical context. And claims for historical uniqueness are usually claims for identity.
Mm-hmm.
You see, this is unique. You say, my suffering is special.
Yeah.
Which I can understand. But as a historian, I would like to explain and understand things. Mm-hmm. Within its the historical
okay,
context.
Okay, so here's a challenge for you, which is often posed to many scholars of the Holocaust. Why Germany? Why did these things, according to your analysis, which is very interesting and takes into account really also the broader civilizational factors that that come into play here, but how do you explain that Nazism took hold, especially in Germany, and much, much, much less so in other places in Europe?
So, that's a very good question, and I think we have to begin by placing this question within the history of modern Europe, modern anti-Semitism. So, indeed, to say that a lot of the things that happened in Germany with respect to the Jews and to other minorities between 1933 and 1945 were common to other places. Persecution of Jews and legal discrimination of Jews actually started in Poland and Hungary and Romania in the late 20s, beginning of the 30s, before the Third Reich. So actually, when we look at the history of the Nazi anti-Jewish policy, until even 1941, it is not completely out of place with what's happening elsewhere in Europe. Mm-hmm. The Romanians, the Hungarians start to kill Jews and other minorities in 1939, 1940, 41.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not only that. So it's not only the Nazis that kill Jews. At a certain point during the war, there is the move toward total extermination. And this indeed is something specific to Germany. And I think we should understand it within the context of the war, the Nazi idea that they are going to build an empire, it's going to be a racial empire. They had plans to kill millions of Poles, of Czechs. So what I want to say, it's not only the Jews.
Where did this idea of an empire come from, and why so late in the game?
So the idea that the Nazis wanted to build an empire is a rather new idea. Historians only recently thought about it.
It seems to me, as a lay observer, that it's something that they always wanted to do, take over
right.
The world. I mean, that's what they were there for.
This is sometimes the power of lay observers over the historians.
Right.
The obvious things are sometimes hidden for the scholars, right. Maybe. So at a certain point, at the beginning, they won a war. They want to win against Poland and against France, but then the war expands. It becomes a redemptive war, a war against Britain, against Russia, against America, against communism, against capitalism, against really everyone.
So it really becomes a holy war in a sense.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. That's how Hitler speaks about it. And then he speaks also about the empire. And then they draw up plans for the racial making of this empire after the war, which calls for making the Slavs in the East slaves. Mm-hmm. The Poles will go only to school until fifth grade because all they need is basic reading.
Yeah.
That's it. Mm-hmm. So people without culture and people without rights, all the people in the East. So when we put the Jews within this frame, what happened to the Jews, we understand that it's not that uncommon in the Nazi imagination.
So it makes sense that the extermination and the dreams of an empire come pretty much at the same time.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And still, I ask, all this is true. However, there is no doubt that the Jews had a special place in the Nazi imagination. They were obsessed with the Jews. They wanted to kill all the Jews. Only the Jews were destined for total extermination. And I ask why. And my answer is, it's because of the place of the Jews in European Christian society since the beginning of Christianity and of Europe. Mm-hmm. So in order to create a new morality and new legitimacy, in order to eradicate the Ten Commandments, and you have to kill the Jews. Mm-hmm. So the Jews symbolize the old time. In order to begin a new time, a new empire, a new civilization that will also legitimize the killing of other Christian Europeans.
Mm-hmm. The first thing you had to do is to get the Jews out of the way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right, Professor Alon Confino, I'm afraid this is all we have time for today. Thank you very much for coming. You're a historian teaching at the University of Virginia and Ben-Gurion University of the Negev, and author of the recently published A World Without Jews, The Nazi Imagination from Persecution to Genocide. It came out in English by Yale University Press last year and will come out in Hebrew next year as well. So good luck there, and thank you very much for coming in today.
Thanks for having me.